días a todos. Mi nombre es Guilherme Ottoni. Yo soy un ingeniero de software en Facebook, en California. Antes de Facebook, yo trabajaba en Intel, también en California. Y a pesar de la distancia que viajé para esta conferencia, mis raíces están muy cercanas de aquí. Yo soy de Rio Grande, en el sur de Brasil. Acá es Buenos Aires, Montevideo, Porto Alegre, y acá es Rio Grande, mi ciudad, donde nací y viví por muchos años. Hace unos 14 años que salí de la. Bueno, no quiero molestarlos con mi pobre portuñol. Entonces, voy a cambiar para inglés. Okay, so I'm gonna start by telling a bit of how we use PHP, why we use PHP at Facebook. And as you guys probably know, back in 2004, when Mark Zuckerberg and his friends from college started a Facebook website, they picked PHP as a language to develop this application. And I think that that was a very good choice, and I think a lot of the success of Facebook comes from the use of PHP because of various features. It's a language that's easy to learn and has lots of extensions. It's well integrated with a website, with a web server. And but most importantly, I think the main advantage of PHP is the fast development cycle that it enables. So the ability to quickly go in an editor and change a file and press F5 and reload the browser and see the change that you just made is very important, especially when designing a very large application. And whoever has ever worked on a static language and in a big project, whenever you make some change and have to recompile, and better go for a coffee or something before you come back. So that's, I think, a very important advantage of PHP. And it actually aligns well with one of the values of Facebook as a company, which is to move fast. And around the campus, we have lots of posters on the walls with to empower and motivate engineers to be bold and try to move fast and break things. This is one of the most famous ones. And it doesn't mean that we want to keep breaking things and breaking the site all the time. It's really saying that we are willing to take the risks and in order to be able to iterate fast and try out different ideas very quickly. And I think a lot of this move fast comes from the fact that we use PHP to iterate quickly. And it's true that PHP also has to do something with the break things part, but that's not going to be the focus of this talk. And to give you guys an idea of how the scale of things at Facebook, here are some data for our website. I cannot give you guys exact numbers, but the site has on the order of 10 to the 5 files, which means like hundreds of thousands of PHP files, and on the order of tens of millions of lines of PHP code. So that's pretty big. And despite that, we still release the site, have 2 releases per day, 10 releases per week for the site. So that's pretty amazing how fast we push things out. And you can check in new code today, and tomorrow it's live for the rest of the world to see. So the real problem of PHP for us is really performance. So here's a graph illustrating relative performance for different languages. This graph shows execution time for a series of benchmarks that were written in different languages, and they are measured relative to C++, which is one here in this graph. So the higher, the worse it is, and you can see that PHP is about 35 times lower than C++, and that's bad, but it's not something specific to PHP. Actually, all the languages on the right here are dynamic languages like PHP, and they perform just as poorly. And that's because of the nature of this language. They're very dynamic. They're usually implemented with interpreters, which are slow. And the language on the left side here are statically typed language, and you can see there's a huge gap between the two. And this bad performance has two main implications for Facebook and other companies running large code base with lots of users. And first of all, bad performance limits the richness of the features that we can implement. So a website is a very interactive application, so there's just so much time we are willing to spend at the server generating the page before we send it back to the client. So if the execution engine is low, then there's fewer things that you can do before you have to send the page back. If you can run faster, you can do fancier things on your website. And secondly, poor efficiency also requires more resources to run the website. And if you think of Facebook, with all the users we have and all the access we have, all the traffic we drive every second, it really means a lot for us. And just to give you guys an idea, here's a picture of one of the data centers that we've built, and we keep building these around the globe in order to support our traffic. And here we have like two buildings in Prime View in Oregon that we built a couple of years ago. And although these little boxy buildings here don't look that impressive in this aerial picture, they're quite big. And in fact, you can fit four full-size professional football fields inside each of these buildings. Four, right? And if you take a small stadium like La Bombonera, you guys can probably fit five or six in there. And inside each of these buildings, we have a bunch of racks with servers, like this one in the picture. And we design our own racks, we design the data centers, we design the motherboards, everything in order to try to improve efficiency as much as possible. So that gives you guys an idea of how important efficiency is for us. So, and inside these data centers, most of the servers are running PHP. So that brought the question whether we can try to make PHP run faster, more efficiently. And that's what brought us to start this project called HipHop about 5 years ago in order to run PHP more efficiently. And the first version of HipHop was actually a static compiler that's transformed PHP code into semantically equivalent C++ code. So that's described in a paper I presented at UPSA last year, and I'm going to give you guys an overview of how that worked. It's not what we use currently anymore, and I'm going to talk about that later, but we still use some of these components of this original compiler in our current system. So HipHop transforms the code into C++, which we then compile with GCC, along with a PHP runtime and our own web server. And then we link all this together, generate a monster binary that we used to ship to all these web servers out there. And the compiler was actually a pretty standard high-level compiler in that it used an abstract syntax tree, just high-level representation inside a compiler, as its main representation for doing optimizations and type inference, which is very important in this scenario. And from that, there was a code generation pass that would traverse the ST and emit C++ code. As I said, very important here was the type inference, because whenever you can infer types for things, we can actually generate a very specific code. So say you can, if you're adding two integers and you know that you're dealing with integers, you generate very specific, very precise code. You can do that in a single machine instruction. If you're, but if in PHP you may be adding, say, two arrays or who knows what. So if you don't know the types, you have to essentially generate code that does a dynamic dispatch, checking what's the type of the first operand, what's the type of the second one, and deciding what the operation is. And type inference will start with every variable, every expression in our, it starts as a variant type, which is the most generic type in our type system, and it's going to try to infer by looking at the uses of the variables to decide what types it can infer, essentially pushing the types down this hierarchy here. So that's how the static compiler worked, mostly. And here are some performance numbers to give you guys an idea of how fast it is. And this includes some benchmarks from the standard bench of PHP, and also from this computer language website. And you can see that here we are showing relative execution time relative to the PHP interpreted label Xana here in this graph. And so the lower the better. And with hip-hop, we can see that it's better than the PHP interpreter across the board. And in some cases, it's faster by a factor of 200 times. And on average, it takes only like 17-18% of the execution time of the interpreter, which in other words means it's about 5.5 times faster than the PHP interpreter across these benchmarks. Of course, benchmarks is not what we cared, and I only did those experiments to write this paper for Upsilon. But for us, what really matters is the performance of the Facebook website. Unfortunately, we couldn't run the website with the PHP interpreted starting in August of 2010, because we added other features to the language that were not supported in PHP, and with that we converted everything to run with hip-hop at the time. And this graph shows that around that time, the relative throughput of the PHP interpreter was only 40% of the throughput we could get with hip-hop, which means hip-hop was about 2.5 times faster, more efficient. And the way we measured the improvements we made over time since then was we had a stable branch where we had this baseline hip-hop here, which is the baseline in this graph, which we only updated with minimum things that we needed for fixing bugs or adding new language features to keep the site running. And we compared, the blue line here is the main branch, that the head of our development branch, with all the performance improvements that we made. And we can see that over the year that came after, until the end of 2011, we gave another about 2.3 times improvement in performance. And at that time, we estimated that hip-hop was about 6 times faster than what our website would run on top of the PHP interpreter. So that's very huge for us. However, there were a few cons in this approach. First of all, having this static compiler compiling to C++ and then compiling to GCC was very slow. And that's not adequate for development. As I highlighted in the beginning, that's one of the main features that PHP developers love, is the ability to quickly see what you're doing. And even though we highly optimized and parallelized all the phases of the compiler, still we spent a lot of time in GCC compiling all the C++ files that were generated, compiling them distributedly with GCC on a cluster of machines, and still doing the linking later. The fastest we could get in the end was about 15 minutes to rebuild the site. Right. That's not very interactive. Right. So the solution we had for that was that for development, we used to have a PHP interpreter that we used. And in production, we would use HPHPC, the static compiler. But that still doesn't create some other problems, because now we have to first maintain two different execution engines for PHP, one for development, one for production. And also, there are some subtle bugs, or I should say, semantic difference between the two that occasionally showed up in issues that we only found after pushing the site to production. So that's bad. Having two different execution engines, one that people are using to develop and another one to ship to production, was not ideal. And another limitation of this approach was that with static compilation, we always miss some code optimization opportunities. First, because there are some inherent limitations of static analysis. There are things that, even though they are true, you will never be able to prove and guarantee it in a compiler. And second, there are code optimization. There are places where you can still optimize the code even when the code is polymorphic. But usually, just because a variable can have different types, maybe most of the times it has one of the types and you want to optimize for that common path, right? So here's like a trivial example. If you call a function foo passing one as an integer once, and then you call it passing a string a bunch of times, then you want to optimize that function for the case where it gets a string and not a number. So that's the second problem with this approach, was that it was hard to leverage this kind of dynamic information to generate better code. So this, both of these challenges led us to start this new approach for running PHP, which is HHVM, which is a virtual machine using just-in-time compilation techniques to run PHP. And we had very ambitious goals here. First, we wanted to have the same execution engine that is very fast to iterate during development, but that's as good as a static compiler so that we can run in production. And we also thought that we might be able to generate better code than we were getting with GCC, because we could leverage these opportunities to leverage the runtime type information. So here's the overall architecture that we went with HHVM. So we still reuse the front end that we built for the static compiler. We built this AST, do some optimizations on that representation. But then, instead of having a backend that speeded C++ code, we now generate a hip-hop bytecode representation, which I'm going to talk a bit in a minute. And that's what we compile all the PHP codes to, that bytecode representation. We have a repo of bytecodes that we ship to production to the servers. And at runtime, as we get requests and start running the code, we start jitting it and compiling it dynamically and generating a dynamic, highly optimized code. So that's the main overview of the system. So one slide on the bytecode representation. It's something that we designed in-house at Facebook. It's a stack-based virtual machine, meaning that it uses a stack for keeping the temporary values as we are evaluating expressions. And it's closer to PHP code than to actually machine code that we generate in the end. Most importantly, it's still untyped. And to give you guys an idea, I'm gonna show some PHP code here and how it gets translated to bytecode. So here's a function in PHP that does something simple, adds the positive numbers among the n first elements of an array here, which are the arguments that we pass. So it just iterates over the first n elements, and if they are greater than zero, adds to the sum variable and then returns it at the end. So here on the right side, you have the bytecode for this that we generated. These numbers here are like the offsets in the bytecode. And we can see that the first statement here is like setting variable dollar sum to zero. So this gets translated to three bytecode instructions, and into zero is going to push on the evaluation stack an integer zero, and then set L2 is setting the value of a local variable whose identifier is 2, which corresponds to dollar sum in this case. And so it sets the value of the local variable with the content of the top in the top of the stack, but still leaves the value, a copy of that value on the top of the stack. And then this popc instruction is going to pop to the top of the stack element. And then we have a similar sequence that initializes $i equals 0 in here. And after that, we have here the evaluation of the loop bound check. So it's checking if $i is less than $n. So this cgetL instructions load local variables and put them on the evaluation stack, the two variables. The less than instruction compares them and leaves a boolean on, pops the inputs and leaves a boolean on the top of the stack, which is whether the comparison was true or false, and then does a conditional jump to 131 here in case that's zero, in case it's false. And here it's gonna load the local variable, put the value on top of the stack, and then a return instruction returns that value on the top of the stack to the caller of this function. So I'm not gonna go through the rest of the bytecode here, it's just to give you guys an idea of how the VM works. So some basic principles in the JIT, right? As I said, we wanted to leverage this runtime type information to be able to generate better code. So the idea is that we want to run the code, observe what types we're getting, and generate machine-specific code for those types. But because that translation will only work for those sets of types that we saw before, we have to insert some guards, some checks in the code to make sure that we're dealing with the types that we're ready to handle. So to give you guys an idea, here's one of the statements that we had in that example that adds $lm to $sum, which gets translated to these five bytecode instructions here, essentially loading the values of the locals, doing the addition, setting the results in $sum, and popping the results from the stack. Right. Once we translate this to machine code, a translation has this basic shape in here. It starts with some type check that's going to check the types that we're dealing with. Say that we got first time both variables are integers, so the translation is going to start by checking, is $sum an integer, is $lm an integer, and if they're not, it jumps back into an entry point in our JIT that's going to retranslate and create a new translation for a different set of types. But if the check succeeds, then we can generate here machine-specific code that assumes those variables are integers and does the proper thing as efficient as possible for that case. Another thing we use is a translation cache. So we keep the translated code in a code cache, which is reused across requests and shared by all the requests that we get. And the way this translation cache so gives us code reuse, so don't have to keep rejitting the code, recompiling the code at every request. And it also, we also chain the translations, as I'm going to illustrate here, in a way that allows us to efficiently look up a translation for a given set of types that you get. So say for that first translation I showed before, we have here a translation specialized for integers. And in case we fail this check, say if we got an integer and a double, then we go to this retranslate entry point in the JIT that's going to create a new translation for the new set of types. Say one variable is a double, the other is an integer, and puts this translation in the translation cache, and it's going to jump to it to execute this code. And it also patches this jump in here so that next time around, if we fail this check, instead of going back and creating a new translation, it's going to jump and try the next one. So if we don't get two integers, it's going to get, okay, do I have a double and an integer? And if you do, you have a translation for it already. And if you fail, then you go back and create a new translation. So there are two other key architectural decisions that were made in the first version of the JITS that I want to call out. And the first one is that a translation unit that we use is what we call a tracelet. It's a small trace of code, and we may, there are two reasons why essentially we break a sequence of bytecode instructions in a tracelet. The first one is in case we produce a value of a type that we don't know what it's gonna be. So we only do guards or checks for values in local variables and this evaluation stack. But say if we load a value from an array in this case, there is this cgetm bytecode instruction which essentially does the load of the value from the array. And we don't know what type we're gonna get out of the array, so we break a tracelet at that point. The other reason we break a tracelet is because of control flow. If there is a branch in the program and we don't know, so we don't know what direction we're gonna go, we stop a tracelet at that point. So in this case here, there's an if in the PHP code checking whether $lm is greater than zero. And in the bytecode, this sequence gets translated to these instructions and ends with a conditional jump in there. So that's the other reason why we break a tracelet in the JIT. And another thing I wanted to call out in this first version of the JIT is that for simplicity, it used a direct translation from bytecode to machine code, Intel x86 code in this case. And there are some inefficiencies that arise from that approach, as I'm gonna illustrate in here. So I'm gonna show some assembly code, machine code, which probably a bunch of people doing PHP never saw before. But I hope you guys can bear with me. So the way we translate this tracelet here from bytecode to machine code, that this is what we get with this first version of the JIT. So the type check becomes the sequence of instructions. That's the first one, is essentially checking that the top of the stack is an integer. So our values are represented as the value and a tag containing what type it is. So this is essentially checking the tag for the value on top of the stack, and RBX is the x86 register which holds our stack pointer. So it's checking if that value is of type integer, and if it's not, it jumps to this retranslate hook that I mentioned. And then here, it's doing the check for the local variable $lm, which is, we're about to override it with this setL instruction. And so we are checking the type of that variable also. And this guard actually here illustrates another optimization that we do in the JIT, which is that we don't always check for the precise type of values. And sometimes we don't care much about the value, just care about some properties of the value that we had in there. And in this case, we only care about whether the value is reference counted or not. As you guys probably know, PHP uses reference counting to keep track of lifetime of objects and decide when to call the structures and so on. And in this case, we're about to overwrite that the value in that variable. And all we care about is whether that value is reference counted or not. If it's not, we don't need to do anything. We just override it. But if it's reference counted, then we need to do a decrement the ref count, check if it gets to zero, and so on. So in this case, we relaxed the guard. We apply this technique called guard relaxation that is gonna just check whether the value is not reference counted. And if it's not reference counted, then all the types that are not reference counted, we can deal with them with the same in the same way. We don't need to do anything in this case. So after the type checks, here are the x86 instructions that are produced by the JIT. And I'm gonna go through here quickly just to give you guys an idea what this is doing. So this is essentially loading the value from the top of the stack. Remember, RBX is the stack pointer. Loading that into register RAX. The second instruction here is loading the value of the local variable into R13, into another machine register. this XOR ECX is an idiom in x86 to zero the value, set the value to zero in a particular register. It's just shorter encoding, so that's what compilers generally emit. And here we're moving the value from RAX that we loaded up here into another register, RDX. And then we're storing the value of this local variable, setting the type tag and storing the proper value. And at the end, we do adjustments of the stack pointer, and we do the comparison and the branch here for this jump Z, actually doing the conditional essentially here in the PHP code. So there are some inefficiencies that I'm going to show you here that arise from this direct translation from bytecodes to x86 code. And first, you guys can see that this instruction here is loading a value into R13 that is never used later. So this is like bad code. And so we can essentially eliminate that instruction and the code runs just in the same way and is shorter and faster. So we want to do that. And there's another opportunity for optimization here. We're essentially assigning RCX to zero here. And this is only used in here in this other compare instruction, which in x86 can take an immediate operand also. So we could compare directly with zero here and get rid of this XOR instruction also. So that's also bad. And finally, there is an opportunity to do copy propagation. So essentially here, we are copying the value from RAX into RDX, which is later used in here. We could use RAX directly here and avoid this copy instruction, right? So that's also bad. And but these are the kind of efficiency that we identified in this initial version of the JIT. And what might come as a surprise is that even with these limitations, we were trying to replace this backend that was compiling with GCC, and we were still able to generate better code than GCC and beat its performance. And here's a graph showing the progress of the performance of the HHVM over time, comparing against the static compiler, HPHPC. So this red line here is the static compiler, and the higher is better. So around May of last year, the JIT was performing just at 50% of the compiler, meaning it was two times slower. And we made a very big effort to optimize the JIT and identify bottlenecks and getting everyone in the team to do performance work. And we were able to, around November last year, get the JITs to perform better than the static compiler. Then it took us a couple months to get it stable enough so that we were confident we could push this to production and kill the old code that was generating C++. And in February of this year, we changed our web servers to use the HHVM and not the static compiler anymore. So that was a major milestone for us. And however, it was kind of hard to get to squeeze more performance out of this JIT for some of these reasons that I illustrated before. It was not generating very good code, but it was hard to improve things the way they were. And one thing to notice here is that around May of this year, we actually got a bump in performance again. And that's actually when we shipped the second version of the JIT, which is what I'm going to talk about next. And around June, it was providing another 20% improvement on top of the initial JIT. So let me tell you guys how we designed this second version of the JIT and how it was able to work around some of these limitations that I showed. The main idea here is that we didn't want to do direct translation from bytecodes to x86 anymore. We want to generate some intermediate code, an intermediate representation that we could do some optimization passes on top of it before we generated machine code. So we came up with this HHIR, the hip-hop intermediate representation, which is uses standard representations in compilers. A static single assignment representation is something, it's a modern intermediate representation that many compilers out there use. So we picked that, and it's a typed representation. Unlike the bytecode, it has type information here. we have guards in the IR, and then the code deals with typed values. And one interesting thing that we did that was kind of specific for PHP was to explicitly represent in this representation the increments and decrements of for reference counting. And the idea was that having them explicit in the intermediate representation allows us to do optimizations that would try to eliminate some unnecessary reference counting that we have in the code. So besides this, the intermediate representation itself, the second version of the JIT also brought a number of optimizations. A lot of textbook compiler optimizations we implemented, like dead code elimination, common sub-expression elimination, jump optimizations, inlining, constant folding, a bunch of stuff you guys can read in textbooks and implement. And this, besides that, we did this reference counting elimination optimization that also turned out to be very helpful for PHP. And finally, the last component of this second version of the JIT was a new backend that we that now translates from this intermediate representation into machine code. And now this is actually the only part of the system that is machine specific. So if we want to port the JIT to another architecture, then we just need to rewrite the code generation that's translating from the IR to the proper the machine that we want to target. Right. With the original JIT, it was very hard. Like it was dealing with semantics of the bytecode at the same time generating machine code. So if we wanted to port that to a new architecture, we had to essentially rewrite the whole JIT. So this was this design is also a lot more portable. And it uses a linear scan register allocator algorithm. It's something very simple to implement and does a good job in general. Runs very fast, it's good for JITs. And that's basically it. So I'm gonna show just a quick example here. I'm not gonna, for the same translation we had before, this is like the intermediate representation that we generate. I'm not gonna go through instructions in here. I just wanna call out that for this code with the version 2 of the JIT, we are able to get rid of those three useless instructions that we had with the first version of the JIT. And once we do that, we have tighter code, we're running fewer instructions, it's faster, it's smaller, it's in the cache, it's even faster, and that's why I got about this 20% improvement over the previous version of the JIT. And this is kind of the state of things, that's what we have today running in production, that's how the HHVM JIT works. And next I'm gonna spend a couple minutes just describing where we are going next to get more performance out of this. And so that's the third version of the JIT, that's what I'm working on with some colleagues right now. And the idea here is that we want to, we realize that having this small compilation units, these tracelets, is hurting us in a number of ways. First of all, there's some overhead to enter and leave a translation that we're paying more often because these regions are very small. If we have a larger region, we just pay this overhead, better amortize these overheads. Right? And secondly, if we have a larger region that we expose to the optimizer, there is more redundancy, more opportunities to optimize the code and generate even better code. So these are the main insights that we're trying to leverage and benefit from in this third version of the JIT. So the way we're gonna create larger compilation regions is essentially by using profiling information. So if you guys recall the two reasons why we break the tracelet, both of them we can overcome by doing more profiling. So one is we usually break the tracelet either because you don't know the type of a value, so you can profile and figure out what types you're getting out of that array that I showed before. And the second one is because of control flow. You don't know what direction you're going, so you stop a tracelet in there. But you can also profile and figure out what paths you're taking and generate a region taking that common path. So we modified the JIT to have two translation modes now. One is a profiling mode, which is essentially the same tracelet JITs that we had before, but we also add some probes in there to collect some profile information. And then once we profile enough, we were satisfied with how much information we have, we retranslate a larger region that we form by looking at this profile information. So here's an example, or the same example from before. I'm going to show what the tracer JIT does and what the region JIT is doing, and to give you guys some insight why it improves things. So for this, here I'm just showing the loop body of this piece of code. The tracer JIT ends up generating all these translations. So each box in here is one different translation. So here's the first translation that's checking the loop boundary here. And it has a guard on variables I and N, which are represented here on the top, checking that they are integers. And then we break the tracelet because of this conditional in here. And for simplicity here, I'm just showing the translations represented by the bytecode, but this will actually be machine code that we generate for that piece of bytecode. And then we start another tracelet here, which is going to guard that it's essentially loading the value from the array. It's guarding that R is actually an array, that I is an integer, and loads the value, and then breaks the tracelet again because it doesn't know what is the value that is going to load out of the array. And then we have the translations to handle the setting the element of the array and doing this comparison, which we break again because of this control flow here. And in this case, we have two different translations because the stack top here may be a double or an integer. Say if you're traversing an array with doubles and integers, we end up generating two translations in here. And for the if branch here, we actually generate four translations because there are two possibilities for types of the sum and the element. They can be either doubles or integers, so we end up generating these four translations. And here's a tracer that we generate just to do the end of the loop. It's essentially doing this increment of I and then jumping back to the top. So the idea with the region JIT is that we want to profile and figure out what's the common path that we're taking here. And say that profile information tells us that these highlighted translations are the ones that we are executing more often. And which correspond to essentially, if you're traversing an array with a lot of doubles, that's the path that you're going to take more often. And if they're most of the time greater than zero, then you are taking this path and not this path in here. So the idea is that once we profile, figure out this is the common path we're taking, we form a region just including these translations, just this path. And now we're going to be able to, and then we want to translate it as a unit and optimize it further. And one simple thing to realize that we can optimize a lot here is just the guards for the tracelets that we have. If you pay attention here, we are like guarding that $i is an integer here at the top. Then we guard that it's an integer again in here, even though we don't modify $i. And then we guard that $i is an integer here at the end. And we're just like incrementing $i, so it's going to keep being an integer, and then we do over and over for every iteration of the loop. And similarly, like $n here, which is never changes this variable, and every iteration of the loop we're checking, is it still an integer? Is it still an integer? But we're not modifying it, right? So the idea is that once we take all these together and form a region, we pass this to the JIT, it's going to be able to do a better job by eliminating some of these redundancies in the guards. Now it can even hoist some of these guards out of the loop. You just check at the beginning that n is an integer and you're done. And it also exposes more opportunities to optimize things, right? If there are things that you know, some values that you know in here, you can now pass them around to later pieces of the code, which before you couldn't because we're jitting each piece individually. So that's what we're working on. We have a prototype running. We're trying to get the site working with this new JIT. We're not there yet, but we can run some benchmarks. And like for this example here, compiling it with the region JIT gives another 25% performance improvement. And it's not even hoisting these checks out of the loop yet. It's like doing the checks inside the loop body. And once we hoist them out, it's going to be more than 25 for this case. So that's essentially what we are doing right now and where we think we can get another good performance improvement for HHVM. Now, enough of talking about the JIT. Now, a common criticism that we get for HHVM is that people say, yeah, it's pretty fast, but too bad that it doesn't run my code. And we know we have this problem. We started this as a small project inside Facebook, mainly focusing on running our application. But we realized that there is a lot of people out there that can also benefit from this. And we're trying to improve HHVM right now to be able to run other pieces of code. So that's one of the focuses of our team right now. And we took like some of the common PHP frameworks from the wild and tried to run them with HHVM. And here's the status of things right now, which is not that good. So there are a few things that run directly, like WordPress, Wikimedia. There are things that if we modify the code, we can get it to work. And there are things that we couldn't get to work, even modify the code for some time, and we gave up. So most of the reasons for this is because there's a bunch of PHP extensions out there that we never supported, we never implemented in HHVM, simply because we didn't need it to run our code base. And now we're adding support for these things in order to be able to run more code.
Tree is already on the green side. Tree.
Yeah?
Yeah, since yesterday.
Okay. Okay, cool. That's cool. Thank you. And the good news is that HHVM is open source. So all of you guys that care and want to use this, you guys can also help us get over there, move more things from the red side to the green side. And here's the URL for the hip-hop compiler on GitHub. We have this website, hhvm.com, also where we have a blog and post things about HHVM. People can also get a hold of us on the Freenode HHVM channel. And we like contributions are very much appreciated. So that's basically what I had for my talk. Just summarizing, HHVM is not HPHPC. We don't do that weird compilation to C++ anymore that people didn't like. It's a lot more like the PHP interpreter works, except that it has a JIT underneath and runs a lot faster. And HHVM has greatly improved the performance of PHP. For our code base, we estimate that today it would run our website about 8 times faster than the PHP interpreter. Of course, we tune a lot of HHVM for our workloads, but even other people converting to HHVM are reporting like 4 to 6 times improvement in performance, which is pretty good. And this has had a huge impact in our data center efficiency, and we think it can help other people also out there. That's why we're making this push to get HHVM more compatible with PHP. And finally, having a better execution engine, even if you don't care too much about efficiency, if you're not running too many servers, just because you have something faster also enables you to do fancier things on your website. Right? So that's another reason to use HHVM also. And as I said, this is open source and contributions are welcome. So that concludes my talk. You guys can reach me out at otoni@fb.com, and I'll be glad to take any questions.